Chapter 2 of the book is about getting started. In order to get started developing serverless applications, we need to look at the serverless offerings and environments for AWS, Azure, and Google, our choices for development platforms and toolkits, and how to set up our environment for them. This is how to get started. All right. As discussed in previous chapter, serverless does not mean that no servers are involved. We mentioned that in the previous video. But rather, the servers are hosted by different third-party providers. Some of the most prevalent providers for the serverless options include AWS, Azure, and Google. And that will be covered in this book. We will examine how serverless options differ from provider to provider. We will also walk through the environment setup processes using Visual Studio Code, Node.js, and Postman. There are many different development tools, environments, and SDKs that can be used to develop serverless applications. We will go over a couple other options in this chapter and later discuss why we will be using the ones specific to this tutorial. What each provider offers: Amazon Web Services, AWS, Microsoft Azure, and Google Cloud Platforms are three of the most prevalent third-party providers in this region, right, for serverless technology. In this chapter, we will discuss the serverless options for each and how they are different from one another. This will give you a better understanding of each offering to help you choose between cloud providers when you write your own serverless applications. So basically, the word serverless here equals to the word cloud in many other books, okay? Let's go through the three options, the AWS, Google, and Azure, right? AWS from Amazon, Google Cloud, and Microsoft Azure. Let's go through each one of these. AWS Lambda, Amazon's serverless offering is AWS Lambda. AWS was the first major cloud provider to offer serverless computing in November 2014. Lambda was initially available only with Node.js runtime. This is the IDE, the developing environment, integrated developing environment, right? But now it offers C#. So Amazon works now with not only Node.js, but C#, Java, and Python, right? Lambda functions are built independently from other resources, but are required to be accessed in an IAM, Identity and Access Management role. This role includes permissions for CloudWatch, which is the AWS's cloud monitoring and logging services. So what is the AWS monitoring and logging services? It is called CloudWatch. What is CloudWatch? It is AWS's cloud monitoring and logging services. What does that mean? It means it monitors and keeps records and track of the events or activities. That's called logging service. From the Lambda console, so the Lambda has a console. From that console, you can view various metrics on your function. These metrics are retained within the CloudWatch portal for 30 days. Figure 2.1 illustrates the CloudWatch login metrics that are available. So this is the https://console.aws.amazon.com/lambda, and home and whatever here things. And here we see AWS Lambda dashboard, and we have the functions here, and we have something called CloudWatch metrics at Galance last 24 hours. And we see that invocation count and invocation duration and invocation errors. And if we go down, we will see a throttled invocations, iterator age, DLQ errors. And the title of this graph, which is figure 2.1, it's called Monitoring Logs That Are Available in CloudWatch. As you can see, for this Hello World function, we don't have any invocations in the last or the past 24 hours. There are even more login metrics that can be seen from the CloudWatch portal, right? AWS Lambda functions can be written in AWS console, right? However, this is not recommended for large projects. Currently, you cannot see the project structure within the console. You can only see the index.js file or the function that is handling the event. This makes it difficult to develop within the console. While you can still export the files from the console to view the file structure, you are then back to being limited by the deployment and testing process. Lambda has built-in versioning. Lambda, Amazon Lambda or AWS Lambda has built-in versioning analyzing tools that can be utilized right from the console as well. What does it have also? It has versioning analyzing tools. Versioning analyzing tools, right? These tools let you create versions of your function and analyze those versions to different stages. For instance, if you are working with the deployment, testing, and production environment, you can analyze certain versions of Lambda function to keep these environments separate. Figure 2.2 illustrates an example of analyzing version of your function. And here we go. This is the 2.2. And here we have analyzes and qualified. And we, yeah. Right. AWS Lambda also makes it easy to incorporate environment variables. These can be set using a key value pair, just like the registry, I guess, because the registry in Windows registry, it works like a key value. So you can use variables throughout your functions to reference protected information such as API keys and secrets, as well as a database information. They also give you a better way to pass variables to your function without having to modify your code in several areas. For example, if a key changes, you can only need to change it in one spot. And we are done with the AWS. Let's go to the second one, the Azure, which is a Microsoft product. After we are done with this, we'll go to the third one, which is Google Cloud. Right, let's talk about the Azure Functions. Microsoft releases its serverless offering, Azure Functions, at Build Conference in 2016. And that's like 8 years ago from now, because we are in 2022. Despite being developed only a year and a half after AWS Lambda, Azure Functions remain a strong competitor in the serverless world. Azure Functions support JavaScript, C#, F#, Python, PHP, Bash, Batch, and PowerShell. Wow. One of Azure's strengths is its ability to integrate application insights with your functions. While AWS also has this capability, integrating X-Ray with Lambda, It is important to point out the power of application insight. This extensible application performance management tool for developers can be used across many platforms. It uses powerful monitoring tools to help you understand potential performance weaknesses in your application. Figure 2.3 illustrates the application insights being used for live monitoring of an application. And here is the figure. Incoming request, outgoing request, overall health servers, live metric streaming. Another aspect of Azure function is that they are built within resource groups, containers used to hold all the related resources for an Azure solution. It's up to the developer to determine how the resources are grouped and located, but generally makes sense to group the resources of an application that share the same life cycle so they can be deployed, updated, and deleted together. Right? And if we keep going up, we'll go to the next one, which is Google Cloud Functions. Google Cloud Functions, the third one. Google Cloud releases its serverless offering, Google Cloud Functions, in February 2016. Currently, Google Cloud supports only JavaScript runtime with only three triggers. When they say currently, this is in 2018. We, after 4 years from that writing of this book, which is now, things have changed, right? It is important to keep in mind that at this writing, Google Cloud Functions is still in its beta release. A lot of its functions and environment is subject to change and more development to its services offering expected. Google Cloud Functions has automatic logging enabled and written to the Stack Driver login tool. Stack Driver login tool. The logs remains in Stackdriver for up to 30 days and log real-time insights as well as custom logs. In addition, performance is recorded for in the Stackdriver monitoring, and Stackdriver's debugger allows you to debug your code's behavior in production. That's very nice to debug the code behavior in production. With Google Cloud Function, you can also use Cloud Source repositories to deploy functions directly from the GitHub or Bitbucket repository, I'm not sure how to pronounce it. This cuts down on time that could be spent manually zipping and uploading code through the console. It also allows you to continue using your form of version control as you would before. A unique aspect of Google Cloud Functions is its integration with Firebase. Mobile developers can seamlessly, let's repeat that part because this is really interesting. Mobile developers can seamlessly integrate the Firebase platform with their functions. Again, one more time. Mobile developers can seamlessly integrate the Firebase platform with their functions. Your functions can respond to the following events generated by Firebase. Real-time database triggers. Wow. Firebase authentication triggers. Very nice. Google Analytics for Firebase triggers. Cloud storage triggers. Cloud PubSub triggers. We will read about what is the PubSub. It's written somewhere here. I saw that in the index. And HTTP triggers. Cloud functions minimizes boilerplate code, allowing you to easily integrate Firebase and Google Cloud within your functions. There is also little or no maintenance associated with Firebase. By deploying your code to functions, the maintenance associated with the credentials, server configuration, and the provisioning and supply of servers goes away. You can also utilize the Firebase CLI to deploy your code and the Firebase console to view and sort logs. To be able to run and test your code locally, to be able to run and test your code locally, Google Cloud provides a function emulator. Emulation is a copy of the main program. Simulation is something that simulates the main program. Emulators cannot be speeded up or slowed down. It's a copy. In simulation, you can speed up things and you can slow it down. Like you have a geographic simulation that makes the 1,000 year passes like in a second. So you see the geographic changes really quick and in an interesting way. But you won't see an emulator that does that for you. So, okay. So Google Cloud all provides a function emulator. This is a Git repository that allows you to deploy, test, and run your application on your local machine before deploying them directly to Google Cloud. A difference between Google Cloud Platform and Azure or AWS is the heavy reliance on API for each service. This is similar to the software development kit used in AWS and Azure. However, it is more low level. Google Cloud relies on an API client libraries to obtain service functionality. These APIs allows you to access Google Cloud Platform products for your code and to automate your workflow. You can access and enable this API through the API Manager dashboard shown in figure in this figure. So we have the consolecloud.google.com, and here's the API Manager, and enable API or disable API and all that stuff. Right, the API Manager dashboard allows you all of your currently enabled APIs, along with the request errors, latency, and traffic associated with this API. The dashboard statistics go back 30 days. All right, explore triggers and events. Chapter 1 gave you an overview of triggers and events and how they fit into the larger idea of serverless architecture. In this scenario, we'll examine what triggers are the next part in the next section, how they work with different code providers, and within real world examples, how events drive serverless functions. So what are triggers? Triggers are simply events. They are services and HTTP requests that create events to wake up. Wake up what? To wake up the functions and initiate a response. Triggers are usually set within the function console or the command line interface and are typically created within the same cloud provider's environment. A function must have exactly one trigger. So trigger wakes up functions. In AWS, a trigger can be an HTTP request or an invocation of another AWS service. Azure functions utilize service triggers as well, but in Azure, they also capture the idea of bindings. Input and output bindings offer a declarative way to connect to data within your code. Bindings are not unlike triggers in that you as developer specify connection strings and other properties in your function configuration. Unlike triggers, bindings are optional. It's not a must. And a function can have many bindings. Table 2.1 illustrates the input and output bindings that Azure supports for its functions. So AWS does not support bindings. Azure support bindings with the triggers. And here are the Azure functions. Input and output bindings for Azure functions. Blob storage, storage tables, SQL tables, no SQL DB. And we have the output HTTP reset or webhook, blob storage, events, queues, and topics. And in the storage tables, we have storage tables. In the SQL tables, we have SQL tables. In the NoSQL DB, we have NoSQL DB, push notifications, Twilio, SMS text, and SendGrid email. So this is Twilio, SMS text, all right? Send the text messages to the mobile apps, to the users, and it charges per SMS, right? It has to be fold, like you have to pay for that service. All right, an example of an application binding trigger to a function is writing to a table within an API request. Let's say we have a table in Azure storing employee information. Whenever post request comes in with a new employee information, we want to add another row to the table. We can accomplish this by using HTTP trigger, an Azure function, and table output binding. Right? And if we skip that, this is called portal.azure.com. All right, let's read this line. The triggers and bindings can be configured in an integrated tab in the Azure Functions portal. Right? And this is the triggers, inputs, and outputs that can be set, configured within the Azure portal. So this is portal.azure.com. It's from Microsoft, all right? The ability to configure outputs using bindings within Azure is something that isn't available with every cloud provider, but having specific outputs based on the reception of trigger events is a concept that is embraced by other cloud providers and one that fit the idea of creating serverless functions to perform single operation. All right. Triggers within cloud providers. So here shows function triggers for AWS, Azure, and Google. And here is the table. So we have AWS Lambda, Azure Functions, Cloud Functions, and AWS Lambda, they have Amazon S3, DynamoDB, Kinesis Stream, Simple Notification Service, Simple Email Service. This is really nice, it sends an email. Cognito, CloudFormation, CloudWatch Logs, CloudWatch Events, Code Commit, Schedule Events, AWS Config, Amazon Alexa, Amazon Lex, Amazon API Gateway. All these are AWS Lambda. And in the Azure functions, we have the Azure Storage, Azure Events Hub, Queues and Topics, Azure Schedule, HTTP REST, or Webhook. And in the Cloud functions, we have the Google Cloud Pub Sub triggers, and we have the HTTP. All right, so function triggers. Again, this is in 2018. This table might be changed now, but this is what's written in this book, and we are skimming this book only. All right, So development options, toolkits, SDKs. In this section, we will look at various development options, toolkits, and SDKs that can be used to develop serverless applications. Specifically, we will discuss TypeScript, Node.js, AWS SDKs, Azure SDK, and Cloud SDK for Google. And this is the TypeScript with Node.js. TypeScript is a superset of Java, TypeScript is a superset of JavaScript that was developed by Microsoft to develop strongly typed language that compiles to JavaScript. It starts with the same syntax that developers who work with JavaScript know and use today. TypeScript compiles directly to JavaScript code that runs on any browser in many JavaScript engines, including Node.js. TypeScript enables developers to TypeScript enable developers to build JavaScript applications that will also include static checking and code refactoring. Figure 2.6 illustrates an example of compiling TypeScript to JavaScript. So this being converted from JavaScript, from TypeScript TS to JavaScript JS. Right. All right. TypeScript can be downloaded using NPM or Visual Studio plugins. Visual Studio can be found on the Microsoft.com website. It can be downloaded for free and used, especially the Community Edition, I believe. All right, from the terminal command prompt, you can install TypeScript with the command npm install dash j TypeScript. This gives you access to the TypeScript tool. In Visual Studio, TypeScript is included by default. So I recommend installing Visual Studio at this point if needed. Once TypeScript, just a side note, in this channel we are skimming books. We're just browsing. We are going fast with books. We're not really doing what the book says. We are not installing Visual Studio and typing code and implementing projects. We are just skimming books. Is doing that something good? Is doing coding and projects is something good? It's really good. But this is not the goal and of our topic, so we don't want to get sidetracked. And we are going to cover like different areas. Why? Because I feel it's useful and joyful. So it's like a hobby, right? Once TypeScript is installed, you can begin writing TypeScript files and compiling them either using command line like this or by building the project in Visual Studio. Once the TypeScript files have compiled, you will see JavaScript files created from the TypeScript files. All right, we are done with that. AWS SDK. Software development kits are powerful tools for developing serverless applications. AWS, Azure, and Google have an SDK with which developers can easily access and create services within each cloud provider. AWS offers SDKs for all the following programming languages and platforms: the AWS, Amazon AWS, Amazon Web Services. Amazon Cloud offer SDKs for Android, for browser, for iOS, for Java, for .NET, for Node.js, for Ruby language, for Python, for PHP, for Go, for C++, and AWS Mobile, and AWS Mobile or AWS Mobile, I don't know. All right, and AWS Internet of Things. To install the AWS SDK, simply type this command at your command prompt, npm space install space aws-sdk. Before you can do this, you will need to have npm installed. Node Package Manager takes care of the installation of you and makes it accessible in your project. So first install npm, right? Node Package Manager takes care of, okay. Figure 2.7 illustrates how the AWS SDK, which is this in the middle here, works with Node.js to deliver accessible AWS services to your code. So you have here Node.js and the browser scripts, and this is called the JavaScript environment. The AWS provide Amazon Web Services, the Amazon S3, Amazon EC2, AWS Identity and Access Management, Amazon SQS, other services, Amazon CloudWatch, Amazon DynamoDB. And this figure illustrates how the AWS SDK for JavaScript allows you to build full-scale application that utilize web services, utilize the services that AWS has to offer with little effort. So the AWS SDK helps. All right. And we have a link here. All right. After installing the SDK, you will need to do something. You will need to do some configuration within your node.js files to load the AWS packages into the application. The way to do this is by using the require statement at the top of your JavaScript. The code should look like var space, yeah, it means variable space AWS equals require AWS SDK. You can then access the various AWS resources using AWS variable you created and the API reference material that can be found here. And here is the details, right? This documentation will show you how to create and access particular services. The following example code shows how you can create a table in DynamoDB using AWS SDK. The AWS SDK will be used in a similar way in some of our demos in the next chapter. It will be a good idea to look over the API documentation to get a better understanding of how these services are created and how they can be used throughout your application. All right, the third one is Microsoft Azure SDK. So we talked so far, if we go back a little bit, we talked about the Amazon SDK, right? And we talked about TypeScript with Node.js. All these are development options, toolkits, and SDKs. So we talked about TypeScript with Node.js, we talked about Amazon AWS SDK, and we'll be talking about Microsoft Azure SDK. Similar to AWS, Azure also have an SDK that you can use when creating your Azure functions. The list of available SDKs for different tools and platforms include these. So Microsoft support.NET, Java, Node.js, PHP, Python, Ruby, Mobile, Media, Android, iOS, JavaScript, Swift, and look at that, Swift, right? And Windows. So they are smart to provide a cloud solution that can be used with iOS and Swift, not only .NET that they created, right? And if we keep going, we will see the Google Cloud SDK. Google Cloud SDK. This was written in 2018. Currently, it might have developed, right? Google Cloud SDK also supports various tools and platforms like Java, Python, Node.js, Ruby, Go, .NET, and PHP. However, since Google Cloud Functions supports only Node.js at the moment, in 2018, the Node.js SDK for Google Cloud is what we will be using to implement serverless applications. That's why Node.js will be used in this book. The cloud, why? Because the Node.js is supported by Amazon, Azure, and Google, all of them, right? Google support Node.js. Microsoft Azure support Node.js. And Amazon AWS supports Node.js. So for that, Node.js will be used because it's supported by all of the three platforms covered in this book. And if we keep going, some technical details are mentioned here, which is really useful, but we are skimming, so we'll just skip that. Developing locally versus using the console. How should you start developing your serverless application? Do you build it locally and then deploy it to the cloud provider, or do you build it within the cloud provider's console? A mixture of both. This section discusses best practices and options for developing locally and within the provider's environment. So here it's about the local development, and as you can see, from it says the for AWS Lambda, Azure can are also do whatever, and Google Cloud, right, and Visual Studio. So it mentions that all over the local development. And if we read this line, developing locally is often preferable. It's often preferable, or it's often preferable. So it's preferable, most likely, because it means you get to use the tools, ideas, and environments you are used to. Okay, so this is preferable, local development. Deploying of functions and resources. There are several options for deploying from local environment to cloud environment. Using serverless framework is a preferred method because it builds condensed deployment packages that are provider specific, so you can use them to build the same application in any account. It is also preferred because it allows you to create independent services and security simultaneously, right? So you create the security as well as the services at the same time, simultaneously at the same time. Another option for deploying from your local environment to cloud is using provider's command line interface. AWS, Azure, and Google all offer CLI, command line interface. that can be installed and utilized to create and deploy various services. Either AWS CLI can be installed if you have Python and PIP using this command. Once the CLI is installed, you can configure your AWS CLI account using the command configure. Right, and Azure using this, and Google Cloud, right? Just like that. Developing and testing in the cloud, in the cloud console. Developing and testing in the cloud console. Developing functions in the cloud console tends to be a little trickier than developing locally. One good thing about developing in the console is that you don't have to worry about deploying the function. All you have to do is test and save them. Azure allows you to navigate through your project and project structure and make changes in the console. AWS allows you to look at your handler file as long as your deployment packages isn't too large to enable inline editing. Google Cloud also allows inline editing for smaller deployment packages. Right. The tools installing VS Code or choosing your IDE, right? Node.js is the only runtime supported by all three cloud providers. So we will also be creating our functions using Node, besides being the only runtime that is completely supported. Node is an event-driven scalable JavaScript that fits the need for building lightweight scalable functions. To install Node, navigate to https://node.js.org/en/download and find the installer that is compatible to your computer, to your machine. It makes a little time to download and the installer and then follow its steps to complete the Node installation. Figure 2.9 shows the node.js download options. Right. So here is https node.js.org en download. And you can download it from here. If you are interested in applying what you are seeing in this book, then go ahead and download it. If this is 200 pages reference, so we are very close to finish 25% of it, a quarter of it, right? After you have installed Node.js, navigate to your terminal for Mac or command prompt for Windows and confirm that the installation worked by running the command node-v and shows the version 7.2.1. Yeah, just like that. I'm not sure if node-v, I'm not sure if I have it installed, so I'm not gonna run that in this computer. If you have Node installed correctly, you should get a response showing the version. Okay. Now that we have Node.js or Node installed, we can begin using it in our serverless demos to expand what Node.js and how it works. Figure 2.11 demonstrates how it operates under the hood to support thousands of concurrent connections. So server creates a new thread from limited pool or waits for available thread. Traditional service, request 1, request 2, request 3, 4, 5. Server Node.js server handles event-based callback on single thread. So request, request, request. Here are threads, here are waiting, right? So this is a single thread, this is multiple threads. It is even event-driven structure and able to process on the fly, makes Node.js an ideal runtime for serverless application, chat application, proxies, real-time applications. Similar to serverless functions, Node is not meant to be used for a long-running CPU-intensive operations. Postman. Postman is another handy tool. It's a tool just like Node.js or the VS, Visual Studio, right? The other one is Postman, and we can install it from this getpostman.com, right? And here's a figure that shows the Postman thing. All right. Postman allows you to save requests so you can easily access them the next time you want to test them. To hit an API, you can specify the method, the endpoint, and any parameters and click send. This will call the API and return any function it gets back to Postman. We will be using this tool throughout the book to trigger our functions that are being executed by API request. Postman will feed us the result of the request and response section in the response section of the application. So Postman will be also used during this book. Environment setup. For the rest of this book, I don't know why I kept making a mistake, okay? For the rest of this book, we will be walking through several function examples using the three things, the AWS, the Azure, and the Google Cloud. To accomplish this, the author recommend a set of tools to be used so that development environments are the same throughout the tutorial. It will be using Visual Studio Code as an IDE and Node.js runtime using Node Package Manager npm and the serverless framework to deploy our functions. So this note is really important. Three things will be used, all right? Navigating versus Visual Studio Code. Here's the Visual Studio. What? All right. More about Visual Studio. Visual Studio Code also provides an extension section that allows you to install and add different extensions to your projects. One extension we will be using is the npm extension for support for Node Package Manager, npm. We can go ahead and install this extension now by navigating to the extension components and searching for the npm in the marketplace. And here is the npm, and it will be installed, or it's already installed. Node Package Manager or npm, what it does, and how to use it. Node Package Manager npm is a package manager for JavaScript, so we will be using it with our Node.js application to install various packages that are needed to complete our project. NPM is very collaborative, allowing you to install, share, and distribute code. NPM include packages such as Gulp, Grunt, Bower, Async, Lodash, and Request. NPM installed along with JS, with Node.js, so we can go ahead and use terminal command prompt to see if we do indeed have NPM installed, and you can do that by typing this. NPM space dash version, and it will show the version, so it's, it says it's installed, right? Serverless framework. The serverless framework is a powerful deploying and deployment tool. With its new release, so basically, you type this serverless npm install dash space dash g space serverless. Right, organizing your development environment. Organizing your development environment. There are many ways to organize your development environment. However, since we will be developing serverless application with the three different cloud providers, it makes more sense to organize by provider than demonstrate how to develop a project that it's provider agnostic. All right. To start, I recommend setting up a Git repository or some sort of version control. You can get a free GitHub account on GitHub to store your code by going to github.com. I created a repository called serverless, then created three projects within it, AWS, Azure, and Google for each project. The author initialized a serverless framework project within it. Inside your AWS project folder, run the command serverless create dash dash template space AWS. Yeah, you can run this command here. Right. All right. And here is the chapter conclusion. In this chapter, we covered everything you need to know to begin building serverless functions. So if you pick one of these or all of that, and you do whatever mentioned in chapter two, you should be ready to start coding. We have the tools and environment set up, as well as the knowledge of how triggers, events, and functions come together to produce scalable event-based application. In the next chapter, we will go through some examples of building functions using AWS Lambda. And at this spot, I'm going to stop the video and proceed. In the next video, we'll be talking about chapter three, AWS.